In this video, we'll start with adding some design constraint to the PCB layout editor. So we don't design something that's very expensive or very difficult to manufacture in a fabrication plant. For this, we'll go to the board setup and then click on constraints. Here, we need to fill in the values that a fabrication plant can handle. So anytime we go above this threshold value, KiCad will warn us and try to keep our design within the manufacturing limit. Usually all fabrication plant will provide a capability list which we can use to fill in this data. If you're just getting started and not sure which fabrication plant to choose, we have a whole section of articles dedicated to that. For now, I'll use this capability list because most of the manufacturers can handle these values very easily. In KiCad, we have these default constraints. Let me quickly explain what and why we have these constraints using some examples. First, we have the minimum clearance. This would be the minimum distance between two tracks. And when we go below this value, we might see some weird artifacts or shorting of the tracks. This is because of the process called etching, which is done during the production. To avoid this, we can always design the board a little above the fabrication's capable value to be on the safer side. So in this case, the capable value is 0.1 mm. But 0.15 is a good value and also is recommended by the fabrication plant. So we'll go with that. Then we have the minimum track width, which is basically the thickness of the track. And similar to the previous value, this thickness is greatly affected by the etching process. If it's anything below the threshold value, the tracks might cause open circuits in the PCB. And according to the capabilities list, it is 0.15 mm. Then we have minimum connection width, which is similar to the track width, but this is the connection between two components or connection between a component and a track. Similar to the track width, if it's less than the threshold value, the PCB etching process might break the connection. So we'll enter the similar value. Then we have the minimum hole size. In this case, it's 0.3 mm. You can go well below this value, but it would make the PCB very expensive as they have to use different process to make the hole instead of just using a drill bit. Next, we have the via size of 0.5 mm and the annular clearances 0.1 mm. Sorry for throwing random words at you, but the video would get longer and longer if I explained each one of them. To solve this, we have created a cheat sheet of all the terminologies into a single page, which you can always refer to when you don't understand these terminologies. So I entered those values over here, 0.3, 0.5 and 0.1 mm. Finally, we have two more clearance values, minimum track distance and minimum track distance between the edge of the PCB. The first value will help in making sure we don't take the tracks too close to the holes, so the tracks won't be damaged while drilling during production. Similarly, the second value will help in making sure we don't take the tracks too close to the edge of the board, so it won't be damaged or chipped off during the final stage of production. The hole-to-hole clearance just makes sense. You can't have two holes close to each other during drilling, so they don't form a single slot instead of two different holes. Then we have microvias. These are way little too advanced for the current circuit that we are working on. So we'll just skip this and go to the silk screen. Here, most of the terminologies are self-explanatory. So I'll just take the values from the capability list and just enter them over there. We'll come back to these values when we are doing zone filling at the end of PCB design. Then we have length tuning, which we can just keep it checked. Next, we have predefined sizes. Let's predefine some track width which we can use in the circuits. It's very similar to how we choose a wire to make the connection based on the current rating of the circuit. For this circuit we are working, we'll just need two different sizes, one for signals and the other one for power tracks. To calculate this, we can use the calculator that's within KiCad. Just go to the KiCad's project window and click on calculator tools. Then click on track width. If you like to know how the calculation is done, you can see the formula is given here with some explanation. Since our circuit is very simple, we can just enter the maximum current it would carry during operation. I'll just enter 1 amp for now. I know the circuit we built in the previous videos won't even be close to 0.5 amps, but decreasing the current consumption decreases the track width, which will make the track width less than our clearance value that we just set a while ago. Then for the temperature rise and trace length, I'll just let them be default. As the circuit is simple and small, these factors won't affect much. Then finally, there is one more factor to include, that is the trace thickness. And for this value, we have to pull up the capability list again. And if you look at outer layer copper thickness, we have 35 micrometer, 70 micrometer and 105 micrometer. In our case, we'll just go with 35 micrometer, which is also the default setting on KiCad. Now, based on the information we gave KiCad, it gives the track width of 0.3 mm, which we'll include in the predefined sizes. There is also something called as internal layer traces. These values we can consider when we are trying to build a multi-layer PCB. So this won't be much of help now. Since now we know the track width, I'll create a 0.3 mm track width for signal, and additionally I'll create a 0.5 mm track width for power. I'm doing this just to show the difference between power and signal tracks. But theoretically 0.3 mm would be good for signal and power in our circuit. Then we have net classes. If you remember from our fourth video about schematics and adding net labels, we discussed how we can give name to few connections for easier understanding. Similarly, we can use net classes and create a group of connections that will share similar properties. For example, we can create two net classes, one for signal and the other for power. Now, using these two classes, we can assign the thickness to the traces automatically. Instead of using the predefined sizes, each time we switch between power and signal tracks. So far, we have just created the classes, but never really assigned the classes to the connections that we made in the schematics. We can do this in two ways. We can either do the assignment here on board setup, or we can do the same on the schematic setup. Personally, I would prefer using the schematic setup. So let me close this. So let me open the schematic editor. Now, if you click on any connection and see the bottom status bar, you can see we have the connection name, but the net class is set to default. But in our case, we want to change this to signal. We can do this in multiple ways, but the easiest way would be just do a right click on the connection and click on assign net class. And under this, the current name is set to /LDR. This is just the net label that we assigned. And here we can set what kind of net class we need to assign for this connection. In this case, we'll set it to signal and click on OK. Now, if I click on the same connection again, you can see the net class is set to signal. Now, if I click on any connections that's related to LDR, you can see the net class is automatically set to signal. We can either do this process for all the connections, or we can go to the schematic setup. And here we can just enter the name of the connection, and KiCad will try to automatically assign the net classes for these labels. So let me do that for mic and set it to signal. And similarly, let me do it for LED and signal. Then we have ground, that'll be the power. Then we have plus 3.3V, that will be power as well. Now there is a slight bit of a problem here. We have assigned the net classes only to the connections that have names. But what about the ones that's unlabeled? For example, this connection, which has the default connection name net D1K and net classes default. Since they are unlabeled, there is no way to search for the pattern without a name that we manually assigned. So how about we manually try to assign? Seems like we can't assign the net to this connection without adding a net label. We can fix this quickly by adding a net label. But this process would become very difficult when we are trying to make a complicated circuit. In KiCad 7, we can solve this by using netclass derivative tool to assign net classes to unlabeled connections. Click on the icon here, add a netclass derivative label. On this menu, select the netclass that we want to assign to the connection. In our case, it's the signal. We can use the below settings to show how they appear on the schematic diagram. In my case, I'll keep it very simple, select the dot And also I'll cut down the length by half. And then hit OK. And now we'll place it on the connections. And personally, I don't like the names that's sticking out. So I'll click the netclass label and press the letter E. And under here, you have the option called show. And I'll just uncheck this and click on OK. Now with this, when we click back on the connection, we can see on the status bar that the netclass has been assigned to this connection. Now I explain how to assign the class name for labeled and unlabeled connections. Let me quickly do that for the whole circuit. Now I have assigned all the netclasses. To just make sure the schematic editor is reflecting all the changes to the PCB editor, I'll close this and open the PCB layout editor. And here I'll open the board setup. And here we can verify board setup net classes and the schematic setup net classes match up. I know this is an insane amount of work for a very simple circuit, but you need to trust the process. These settings will really help a lot in making a very good PCB at the first try. I keep using these sentences from the past two videos that we'll be bringing the footprints that we assigned into the PCB layout editor. But so far, we took so much time just talking about the constraints, PCB layout editor, and so many other things. But in the next video, we'll make sure we get all the footprints into the PCB layout editor, and we'll finally start working on our first PCB. And we really appreciate any doubts or questions related to the topic that we're making. And we are always thrilled to answer each one of your questions. But please try to consider PCB Cupid Q&A for a few of the questions. All you have to do is just a one-click login and ask your questions. It'll really help us in producing more videos frequently. Also, it'll help many users who are just getting started with KiCad. So until next video, keep learning and keep creating.